you doing?
Good, are you?
Pretty good.
Pulling whatever the hell you want.
What do I do with it?
Cat, make a knife. So what that'll do is that'll give you two of those.
Ready to make contact.
And it you're creating a middle to high carbon steel or carbon content, but it's a bloomery style material, so it has a slide inclusion and stuff. So it's like carbonized wrought iron.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever bought it going in like nickel or anything in there when you're doing this?
All fixed? Yeah. So Mr. Robertson suggested that.
So have you put your bloomery iron in one pan?
We call it those full bars, but also the grommets. Most grommets have to come off, and you have to forge it up. And the problem with the grommets is they've got a lot more slag in them, so they tend to need to use more to get the result out of the bottom. And I didn't bring that one, but they pretty growly, but yeah, we certainly have done.
So, have you tried doing the bleach for you?
You're looking to pick one up?
Yeah, I got that from Kurt Shaw, who is 2 hours north of Texas. So, I don't know if you'd be able to find that. That's Lloyd, I know he's always looking for the blowers. Yeah. If you've got a big collection, so you might be able to put you in the right direction.
I just made my goal for it.
Oh, yeah.
So what I'm going to do, gentlemen, in terms of the handout, is I've made it up as a PDF. I'm going to link it off the website, the OABA website.
For that, I got to rely on.
So you can just download the one page. And I put a really, really brief
working out for you.
Main point without any explanation how to do this. Lee Sauter has about a 10-page article that he published,
cool.
And then Jesus Hernandez, remember him from Fan Iron, he went home and he did a photo essay of running this furnace and then converting it through into a finished blade, which is great because it's got all the photographs as well.
If you know anyone,
so I've got all those web.
I know somebody who's looking for a little gas furnace to get started with.
Yeah.
I could put a thing in the newsletter.
You'll find a link. I'm going to hold it on my site.
What are you aiming for?
Okay.
I'll let him know if he's interested.
Like I said, I was hoping to be able to...
Like ballpark, what are you? If your best offer is $10, you're not going to go for it. So.
Yeah, you wouldn't be able to do this with GoPro.
What are you hoping for anyway?
No, remember, we're liquefying.
Around 100.
That was the big technological change.
Other than I'll trade it for coal.
In the 1600s, is they figured out how to use coal to avoid the sulfur contamination. Because we're liquefying the metal, right?
But you don't have an armature, no metal in there.
Do you want in here?
Well, the guy who made up this mix made it a little sloppy, so it started to sag on me. But you can see I just wrapped it with some cord while it was drying.
But you're telling me you're screwed up.
Well, it happens, you know.
Every day.
There is no metal frame inside.
No, it's just a ceramic. This is ceramic. You could probably take a piece of 6-inch diameter weeping tile. Remember that old red ceramic weeping tile? And Lee and Skip worked out a test furnace where they took that red ceramic and they mixed up shredded cellulose insulation 50% with clay, and then put a layer, about a 1/2-inch layer of that around the outside, and then bound it up with chicken wire. And that's a full-size furnace, and we've run one of those 3 or 4 times in a row. So on this scale, that would be another really fast way to make one of these.
Would a clay tile work out all right?
The size is the thing. Yeah, you want to get the right size. If you use a full-size square tile, what you've got is a smelting furnace, not one of these. Yeah, and we use that as a teaching furnace.
Just for the general kind of drainage pipe, just so you want to hear it.
Yeah.
I would just want one of those drainage tiles, so let's leave.
Like I said, all we're trying to do with the enclosure is, number one, it's got to stand the heat. And then the more care you put into building it, the longer it lasts. But they're so cheap. The European guys are all over that. They're all worried about how long their furnaces last. God, it's mud, guys. Just make another furnace.
Yeah. You know?
Yeah, you've got to change for 20 times.
Well,
Well, I'm talking to the guys in Denmark when I was over there, because they just dig it out of the ground, it's ready to go. They don't even have to do anything to it. You can wheel throw it straight out of the ground.
Darrell, you said 50-50 hard parts and
powdered clay, yeah, just ball clay. Yep.
Ball, by volume or by weight?
By volume.
By volume.
Yep. Okay. Let's mix it up real well.
Where were you in Denmark, Darrell?
I got invited to go over to an iron smelting conference in Helpwork, which is about halfway up the Jutland Peninsula.
Jutland, yeah, Aarhus and so forth. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, that was 2008.
Now, what's the drying time on the furnace before you use it?
If you're careful when you do the preheat, you can put the preheat right as soon as you finish building.
Oh, really?
Yep. Preheat can be the drying time.
Yep. Yeah, you just have to be careful. You don't want to heat it too fast, right?
Okay.
So you do this without melting the camera.
Yeah. So you can see we're getting close. People like Jim wearing nylon jacket, just watch the little sparks and stuff coming off. Okay. You don't care about getting holes in it.
We don't give a shit when we're burning.
So you can get the last little bit of charcoal out. Okay? And then you want some kind of a hooking device. Remember, the puck is gonna take up most of the bottom of the furnace, so it's got to be small enough that it can get around the edges. And then a long-handled pair of tongs that'll reach down in there and grab the thing. So that's what we're going to do, is we're going to scoop up the last of the charcoal in a second here, and then I'll loosen the puck, and then we'll just pull the puck out. Now, I'm not set up here to actually do any forge work. Obviously, this is at its optimum temperature as soon as we extract it. So the ideal thing to do would be to have an anvil handy so that we could tap it down. If anybody is feeling really, really ambitious and wants to grab this thing and run off inside and forge it,
we might be able to bring one out.
By me, you know?
Would it be your advantage when you're forging it if you have an anvil?
No, it's just we're essentially working
maybe
in a welding.
It's advantageous to have an anvil
right
here.
Yeah.
And the hammer, but it would be the anvil would be too cold because that chunk would be cool enough.
Sometimes, Jack, you don't even need to scoop up.
Trying to get a video.
Sorry.
For that.
This is where we find out if there's actually anything in there. I'm gonna feel like an idiot. I feel like one.
That is the anvil through the bottom.
Okay. And there what we got. Look. Look at that. Look at that. So you can see it's got that same texture as a bloom, right? You see how it's collapsing? Well, there's a nugget in the center there, obviously. Now the thing you gotta watch when you start to do this is something Lee Slaughter told me, okay? He knows way more about this than all the rest of us put together. Is you're kind of squeezing it down. He says to think of these blooms like it's a piece of lemon meringue pie. And the lemon in the center is a solid, more or less solid metal. But around the outside is that egg whitey custardy stuff. Now some of that slag, you can see how it's breaking off. But if you hit it too hard, it just disappears. And you want to keep it hot when you first start to walk. I wouldn't want to work it any further down than that.
What about we reheat it?
Well, okay, somebody wants to do that is welcome to, okay? I can't weigh this really easy.
I'll bring your tongs right back.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you can see what we got there, guys. That's a little piece of bloomery material. Now, an interesting thing to do would be to try spark testing it and see what our carbon content is. Because we should have taken our mild steel and increased it up with this furnace something about 60% or 0.6. You know what I mean, right? Yeah. You know what I mean, right? A little bit better than a spring steel.
60 points of
carbon.
Yeah.
which, you know, for me is a nice blade making material. Easy, eh? Sometimes, Jack, you don't even need to scoop up the excess debris.
Sorry. It's for the...
And this is where we find out if it's actually in the unit. I'm going to feel like an idiot. Oh, no. I feel like one. See that?
That is
the
answer
graphic
for the bottom.
Okay. And there what we got. Look.
Oh, look at that.
Look at that. So you can see it's got that same texture as a bloom, right? You see how it's collapsing? But there's a nugget in the center there, obviously. Now the thing you gotta watch when you start to do this, this is something Lee Slaughter told me, okay? He knows way more about this than all the rest of us put together. Is you're kind of squeezing it down. He says to think of these blooms like it's a piece of lemon meringue pie. And the lemon in the center is a solid, more or less solid metal. But around the outside is that egg whitey custardy stuff. Now some of that slag, you can see how it's breaking off. But if you hit it too hard, it just disappears. And you want to keep it hot when you first start to walk. I wouldn't want to work it any further down than that.
What about we reheat it?
Well, okay, somebody wants to do that is welcome to. Okay? I can't weigh this really easy.
I'll bring your tone straight back.
Yeah. But you can see what we got there, guys. That's a little piece of bloomery material. Now, an interesting thing to do would be to try spark testing it and see what our carbon content is. Because we should have taken our mild steel and increased it up with this furnace something about 60% or 0.6. You know what I mean, right? You know what I mean, right? A little bit better than spring steel.
60 points of...
Yeah, 60 points of carbon. Which, you know, for me is a nice blade making material. Easy, eh?
Yeah.